Hachette Audio presents The Conspiracy to End America. 5 Ways My Old Party is Driving Our Democracy to Autocracy. Written by Stuart Stevens. Read by Jeff Bottoms. Dedication. For Ukraine, at a time when many Americans seem to take democracy for granted, Ukraine reminds us of the price. A massive fraud of this type and magnitude allows for the termination of all rules, regulations, and articles, even those found in the Constitution. Donald J. Trump, 45th President of the United States. Introduction. I remember the moment clearly. I was watching the sun come up in Park City, Utah, where I'd been working with the Lincoln Project to defeat Donald Trump. It was a couple of weeks before the 2020 election, and it had been another all-nighter. One of many during that campaign and my personal war against Donald Trump and the modern Republican Party I had helped create. I just finished one of the over 300 videos we frantically produced in just a few months, and I was tracking the latest polling from the handful of key states: Pennsylvania, Wisconsin, Michigan, Arizona, Nevada. This was the 6th presidential campaign I'd worked on, and I felt like I had spent half my life locked in rooms working the numbers in those same states. I had helped elect governors or senators in all of them, and could discern the patterns developing in the often confusing and contradictory flow of data. In that instant, the fog of political war lifted, and I could see the outcome with confident clarity. Donald Trump was going to lose. Joe Biden would be the next president of the United States. I sent off my latest video and fell asleep, allowing myself to think about life after Trump. As a media consultant who had helped elect more Republicans to top office than any in my tribe, I felt a deep personal responsibility for what the party had become. After the 2016 election, that burden drove me to write It Was All a Lie: How the Republican Party Became Donald Trump. But that morning before the 2020 election, I felt that my duty had been done. I had fought as hard as I could and used every bit of my skills to blow up the Death Star of Trump. I could not change my past. My political memory would always play in the key of regret. But I was free to move on. Had you asked me that morning if Republicans would accept defeat if Joe Biden won by over 8 million votes and north of 300 electoral college votes, my answer would have been simple. What else could they do? Well, they wouldn't like it. But when you walk off the field of the Super Bowl, the score is the score. Endless hours would be spent by the despondent losing fans, analyzing what could have been done differently, but none of it would matter. The final scoreboard was never wrong. I should have known better. Any faint hope I had that the Republican Party might seize on a Trump defeat as an impetus to self-correct was quickly destroyed. I watched Republican senators and congressmen I'd helped elect, men and women I knew to be sane and decent, refused to acknowledge what grade school children knew to be true. Donald Trump had lost the 2020 race. When I spoke to a few, I heard variations of, "We're just humoring him. What harm can it do?" Soon their answer would come, as they ran for their lives from domestic terrorists their leader had called to action and their complicity had emboldened. The greatest danger is often not recognizing the greatest danger. The need I experienced before the 2020 election to believe there was a salvageable normal in American politics was as predictable as it was dangerous. But today's Republican Party is not a normal political party in the American tradition. It has become an autocratic movement masquerading as a political party. If we look away from that truth, we greatly increase the likelihood that the America we love will slip away, never to return. Whenever a democracy slides into autocracy, there are five critical elements at work. All of these are active today in American politics. The tendency is to examine each as if it is an isolated phenomenon, troubling perhaps, but manageable by the American system. This illusion is the hope of the autocrats and a potentially fatal mistake. Each of these is part of a greater whole that together threatens the existence of the American experiment. This book is an urgent warning to examine collectively the power of the forces working together to end American democracy as we know it. The five autocratic building blocks are propagandists, support of a major party, financiers, legal theories to legitimize actions, shock troops. This is the conspiracy to end America. All are growing in power and influence as their cumulative impact metastasizes more dangerously every day. Fox News is a small part of an entire ecosphere of media that looks to autocrats like Viktor Orban of Hungary as their role models. American oligarchs like Peter Thiel, who has openly voiced his opposition to democracy, combine with a vast online base of small donors to provide virtually unlimited funding for their cause. The Republican Party refuses to admit that America has a legally elected president. After the coup attempt of January 6th, Republicans in 47 states introduced legislation to change voting laws, the product of a quiet right-wing legal industry that has been at work for decades, methodically altering the legal framework of democracy. The insurrectionists who stormed the Capitol are now heroes and martyrs to a fierce network of men and women who believe they have a moral obligation to remove the current illegal occupant of the White House. Donald Trump has summoned them to fight the final battle. They are answering the call. This is not theoretical for me. I know many of these people, know their world and how they function. As dangerous as they may seem, they are worse. This is testimony to a corrupt system I helped construct. A book I never would have imagined writing in my years as a Republican political consultant. Now, it is a book I can't imagine not writing. It is not too late to save American democracy. But it is too late to pretend that the danger is not great, and the time grows short. Chapter 1. The Propagandists. Those who manipulate this unseen mechanism of society constitute an invisible government which is the true ruling power of our country. Edward Bernays, Propaganda, 1928. I fell into political media consulting by chance. I was in film school at UCLA and got a call from the chief of staff of a congressman I'd worked for as a page when I was in high school. That congressman, Thad Cochran, was now running for the Senate, and his chief of staff, John Hinson, had decided to run for his congressional seat. His Democratic opponent was the son of powerful Mississippi Senator John Stennis, and it seemed everyone expected him to win easily. "I don't have money to hire anybody to make commercials," Hinson told me, "so you have to do it." I told him that was interesting, but I didn't know how to make commercials. "I just make these stupid little films," I told him. But Hinson was desperate, and I had always loved politics, so I finally agreed to give it a try. Hinson ended up winning an upset, mostly because he was in the right place at the right time, and to my great surprise, I discovered people would pay me to make commercials. I could do it sort of seasonally, like migrant labor work, I presumed, taking a few months to work in campaigns while I tried to find a way into the film and writing world. Early in his second term, Hinson would resign from Congress.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.